in choir unless you do this. Happy birthday, Dan.
Hear the word of the Lord from Isaiah 9, verses 2 through 7. The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Those who lived in a land of deep darkness, on them light has shined. You have multiplied the nation. You have increased its joy. They rejoice before you, as with joy at the harvest, as people exult when dividing plunder.
The yoke of their burden and the bar across their shoulders, the rod of their oppressor, you have broken as on the day of victory. For all the boots of the trampled warriors and all the garments rolled in blood shall be burned as fuel for the fire.
His authority shall grow continually, and there shall be endless peace for the throne of David and his kingdom. He will establish and uphold it with justice and with righteousness from this time onward and forevermore. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will do this. Glory to God in the highest. Hallelujah.
He went to be registered with Mary, to whom he was engaged, and who was expected. expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for her to deliver her child. And she gave birth to her firstborn son and wrapped him in bands of cloth and laid him in a manger because there was no place for them in the inn. In that region, there were shepherds living in the fields, keeping watch over their flock by night. Then an angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid. For see, I am bringing you good news of great joy for all the people. To you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign for you. You will find a child wrapped in bands of cloth and lying in a manger." And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace among those whom he favors." When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let us go now to Bethlehem and see this thing that has taken place, which the Lord has made known to us." So they went with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the child laying in the manger. When they saw this, they made known what had been told them about this child. And all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds told them. But Mary treasured all these words and pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all they had heard and seen as it had been told them. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. We will now sing the next hymn. Chickens, which in our case was practicing holding them upside down in order to move them around the easiest ways to grab them by the feet. Or so I was told. And I also remember the hot cocoa warm-up we all received when the evening was complete. And while scripture does not tell us that either hot cocoa or animals specifically were present at Jesus' birth, these are part of my own memory of connecting with the nativity story. I'm sure that all of you have memories where certain details stand out and are in some way important to your specific memories of Christmas as well. The nativity story given us in scripture is a common memory, however, for all of us, and is why we as Christians both celebrate the Christmas season and, like those shepherds long ago, can still appreciate and feel the happiness and innocence of that scene in the manger. The incarnation of the Son of God is a memory alive. There are two accounts of the Nativity in the Bible, in the Gospels of Matthew and Luke. In Luke's account, the emphasis, which was read for us this evening, the emphasis is marvel and rejoicing. The main characters are Mary and Joseph, angels of the Lord, shepherds of the field, and the baby. These are all the witnesses for the Nativity. In the Nativity story given us in the Gospel of Luke, the context for all witnesses is a moment divinely named, given us explicitly in Scripture, as joy. Think of moments in your own life that were so clearly of a joyous essence. Remember the happy, healthy birth of infants in your life. Recall a time when you were given a warm hand up, no strings attached, when you really needed it. Picture the smile on the face of someone you love, who you thought might never smile again, and the way that made you feel. For both Mary and the shepherds, this sort of joy surrounded Christ's birth. The shepherds' response to the proclamation of the divine messengers was at first fear, but next curiosity. They had to go find out. And then finally exuberance. However, Mary's eventual response in Luke chapter 2, verse 19, to the same message after the arrival of the shepherds in Bethlehem was this: Mary treasured all these words and pondered them in her heart. Mary's response. Mary treasured all these words and pondered them in her heart. Mary's interpretation of the birth, of the joy moment, was more complex than that of the shepherds and all the rest who they told. Mary understood that rather than being the answer to all of her questions right then and there, all her heart's desires, the day of her child's birth multiplied her questions tenfold. She realized that the Christ child was a delicate infant, just like any other. The baby would need protection, nurturing, and teaching. Yes, her little child was certainly a great gift to all the world, but rather than claiming fame, her heart pondered it all. It would seem normal for Mary to wonder how she and Joseph would do it. How would this very special baby survive the attention, both positive and negative, to grow to be the foretold Messiah? Or without even the knowledge that Mary's child was this light of the world, how would she do all the things she would need to do as a new parent that she had never done before? Was she ready for that? Is that like something that has been a part of your life? If you are a parent, it surely has. But also, if you have ever been given a responsibility that affected anyone else, it surely has also. If you have been promoted in the workplace, if you have joined a church, if you have entered into any sort of new relationship, there's been something like this in your life. You celebrate the event, and then what happens next? God is doing things in the world that interacts with each one of you. When God places you in a new context, a new relationship, When you're in the midst of struggle or in the throes of jubilation, God is there in relationship with you. And God will be there in whatever happens next. What Mary was really pondering in Luke 2:19 likely transcended thoughts about her own role in Jesus' life. One of the reasons that Mary is such a revered figure in traditions of spirituality is due to the way her humility is understood. Despite her own sacred position as the bearer of God's Son on earth, she did not allow her opinion of herself to skew. She gave glory to God, not herself. Based on the limited amount we do know of Mary from Scripture, it's consistent that her pondering in her heart on that historical Christmas day was more about what God was going to do next, what God was going to do in Jesus to fulfill that name as Prince of Peace. Also, how God would be specifically continuing to call Mary into the service of God's mission in her own lifetime. So as we wake up tomorrow, let us have a Merry Christmas, being like all those people who heard the good news from God's messengers at Jesus' birth. And after sharing in our gift-giving and joy-filled celebration for the duration of this Christmas season, let us then remember Mary's Christmas. God is active in this world and is with us in every moment. Our faith in God and the ever-shining light of Mary's child urge us to wonder, to anticipate, and to serve with a pondering heart. Let us, like Mary, not only remember God's presence among us in just one season, but look for it every day hereafter. Amen.
Thank you. Yet they held to the promise that God's chosen one would someday come to set them free, releasing them from the hopelessness of their long dark night. And so they waited for the morning star to rise. The sun shall no longer be your light by day, nor will the brightness of the moon shine on you, for the Lord will be your everlasting light.
Joseph, I've been divinely chosen by God.
cloth and placed him in a manger, for there was no room for them in the inn. This fulfilled the prophecy of Micah. But you, O Bethlehem, though you are small among the clans of Judah, out of you will come one who will rule over all of Israel.
Thank you.
the shepherds returned to heaven, they said to one another, "We must go to Bethlehem to see this child, and all that has happened which the Lord has told us about." So they went with haste to search for the newborn Messiah. There they found Mary, Joseph, and the baby who was lying in a manger, just as they had been told. After they had seen the child, they joyously spread the word about what they had witnessed. All who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds told them.
Thank you.
On this Christmas Eve, as the light of your word penetrates our hearts, as we are reminded of the gift of life and faith, as the glories of the heavenly host are echoed in our church, we open ourselves up to your Spirit and give you thanks. We are grateful, Lord Jesus, that your story has become our story and that we celebrate your birth. Continue, we pray, to instill in us a profound sense of your abiding presence and help us to take to heart the wonder of your love, that we may walk in your ways and delight in your will. Help us, Lord God, to be the faithful, gracious, loving, giving, forgiving, and thankful people you would have us be. Now we pray together the prayer that you taught your disciples to say. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
great God, as you came at night when all was still, so enter our lives this night. Illumine our paths with the light of Christ's presence, that we may clearly see the way before us, the truth to speak, and the life to live for him, our Lord Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.